Why, hello, everyone. Welcome to History Spaces. I'm Jerry Anderson, and I'm here with Jeff Messerman, as usual. Hey there, Jeff.
This feels like a new show.
Yeah, I think, people may have noticed we have a new theme song. Benny Goodman and his orchestra doing All the Cats Join In. One of my favorite old big band tunes.
And thankfully, he doesn't have a legal team, so he won't sue.
So we can use that as much as we want. That's right.
The world of the happy world of public domain. That's what it is.
Yeah, he grew up in Chicago, and I guess he got his first clarinet from Hull House. You know, that settlement house that's very famous in Chicago, and he got his music lessons there, and that's where he got his start, and then he ends up being this huge success.
Oh, absolutely.
So
I mostly know his story from thanks to Steve Allen, because he played him in the movie. So,
okay.
And actually, according to Benny Goodman, he said, I love the movie. It was great, but it had very little to do with my life. So...
Well, it's just like the new movie Harriet. I was mentioning that earlier when we were speaking. That, I mean, it was a very nice movie. Really enjoyed it.
Yeah.
Celebrating her and her bravery and all that she did, but completely overlooking the fact that she was underappreciated, not appreciated, and really got, well, I just have to come right out and say it, screwed over despite all of her service during the Civil War. They wouldn't even give her any pay or a pension. And later on in life, she married a Civil War veteran. And then when he died, and she was very old, they finally granted her a pension of $8 a month.
Ooh.
And that's all she ever got. Not that she was doing it for that reason. However, it just goes, that truth there that I'm mentioning just goes to mention, just goes to illustrate the fact that black people were so undervalued, unappreciated, and treated as less than human. And Absolutely. Even no matter what they did, they were always treated on that lesser level. And
we're still recovering from that as we speak.
That was something I really objected to in the film, but I don't know. How do you balance that?
Another film to history thing that took grotesque liberties, but was still a terrific, and this is an interesting thing, it made a great movie, was from a few years back, Saving Mr. Banks, about P.L. Travers and her bringing Mary Poppins to Walt Disney.
Right.
And the movie is, and Tom Hanks, America's nicest man, apparently.
Yes.
And recent Global Golden Globe. He got the DeMille Lifetime Achievement Award this past week. So
I saw his speech.
Yeah, delivered a very nice speech.
Wonderful.
Yeah, a lovely guy. But the film is just... Harlan Ellison, who was, I believe, kind of there for a lot of that sort of in the background, he said, this made an absolutely glorious movie, but... They, it is more science fiction than anything I ever wrote. So,
well, if you want history, you read a book. You don't go to the movies.
Or you could listen to this fine, fine show that we have resurrected.
Yes, here we go. We have a lot to say today, don't we? Well, you don't, as usual, you don't know what I'm going to be talking about, so.
I glanced this week, but I didn't go deep. I just a passing glance, although I saw, I have a feeling, as always, your main topic has nothing to do with where we're going.
Not where we're going. No, and when I did my research for today's show, I was just struck on all the little side streets that one could go down and all the things that were related to this, and you could just wander through all these halls and get lost.
Well, you and I should work for the Department of Public Works, because certainly on this radio show, we're all about side streets. We could get them plowed very nicely.
Yeah. And so, but I was also struck by the fact that there were so many conflicting stories about so many of the things I was trying to nail down as factual. And so it kind of reminded me of the old quotation by Mark Twain that he said once when someone was talking about his ability to tell a story, he says, well, I can remember anything, whether it happened or not. And so I think I'm going to adapt that sort of thing and
the
just throw it out there
here.
And encourage you and everyone else out there to do their own research. Okay, so let's see. What do we have in my little page of notes here. In the late 19th century, that's who we're going, late 1800s, Cambridge University in England was one of the most eminent schools in the British Isles. The sons of the rich and wealthy went there for their educations, Jeff. Just like they go to Harvard, Yale here, I guess. Besides attending to their studies, students at Cambridge then engaged in sporting activities, which were offered for their health and entertainment. One of the most popular sports was competitive rowing. We call it sculling.
Yep.
And the members of the university rowing team were some of the coolest and most fashionable and sought-after young men on campus.
I see why they rejected my application now.
Yes. Can you scull?
I guess not that version.
Yeah. But anyway, these people on the sculling team, they were greatly admired, the big jocks on, you know, big men on campus. This led, it seems, to them feeling somewhat special because they were recognized wherever they went on campus, you know, really big. The young men were trendy and very much in vogue, but the amount of popularity they enjoyed, Jeff, was apparently not enough for their very expanded sense of self-importance.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
I like them already.
Yeah, they're not. No, not important. Let's see how more important we can become. So.
I've been told by many people that I've met a lot of important people, and I know that because they have told me.
Oh, there's a sign there. Let me decide how important you're going to be to me.
My favorite line, of course, is, "Don't you know who I am?" I always respond really well to that.
No, tell me.
Yeah, exactly. You are.
Well, Jeff, don't you know who I am? I mean,
that's right.
When I walk into the library, heads turn.
That's right. There's that history guy.
Oh, gosh.
You should throw your weight around town more often, Jerry.
Well, I was humbled the other day when I ran into you by the checkout desk, and we were talking about the radio show, and the gentleman next to me said, "Oh, you have a radio show." And he said, "What's the name of your show?" And I said, "History Spaces." How nice to see a fan. And he just looked at me with a blank face. He had no idea what that show was or who I was. And
I think perhaps he was thinking to himself, those radio people.
I know. Well, we're kind of a throwback, though, Jeff.
I think so.
You know,
yeah,
we
everything
are.
We do here is at CPL Radio is a throwback.
So,
you know.
Welcome, all of you people
Thank
who
you.
Are
Absolutely.
Into this. Yes. Now, back to Cambridge. These scholars and members of the rowing team were members of the St. John's College Cambridge Boat Club. That was their the title of the club they belonged to. Excuse me, Jeff.
All right.
And in 1889, they decided on a plan to attract even more attention to themselves, Jeff. One of the members of the club came up with the idea of a unique jacket that would be worn only by the members of their rowing club. They designed it to be unlike the jackets of their parents' generation, which were longer and more formal looking. So a tailor was called in to take the measurements of each of the young men. And the task was completed. And the last decision to be made was, what color should these jackets be? The color chosen was one that is best described as, Jeff, fire engine red. Kind of almost, well, you're close to fire engine red. Jeff's got a
in my
nice shirt on.
In my desperate attempt to be a sculler, I threw this on today.
Well, I think this is just a coinky dink of the first order. I mean, really. Yeah. Now, fire engine red. It was chosen by the club because it would make them, get this, I love these guys, it would make them even more conspicuous on campus.
Wow.
Now they could be seen coming from a long distance away before they'd even be personally recognized. Someone would say something like then, look, it's a member of the rowing team coming along. And other students would say other things, but that was what they were aiming for.
You know, if you're that desperate for attention in a crowd, I've always suggested people just wear nothing. mean, that's always been my, you know.
Remember, this is the Victorian era, however. Yeah, that's preventing it. Probably, that's all underground stuff, which is another whole thing to read about.
Well, there go our ratings.
Now, this made young men who are already full of themselves even more visible to the rest of the student body. Now, at this point, the new fashion statement started to backfire on the members of the St. John's College Boat Club. You know, I mean, enough is enough. You know, the public is going to stand up eventually. Now, maybe politically, we could get, I could see a door open here, but I'm not going to go through that one, Jeff, okay?
It's way too early in the new season to
We're
go
We're in election
that.
Season, yeah. And we'll see what happens.
Should be a fun year for History Spaces.
Yes. Now, other members of the student body began to resent this conceit on the part of the already popular young men. And now, instead of being admired for their status, the scullers, or rowers, started hearing taunts and insults thrown their way. Some of the remarks were crude, but others were similar to the following, such as this. Quote, hey, you look as if you're on fire. And, quote, you look like you're ablaze. Watch out, unquote. These last two more mild comments led to the creation of the disparaging term blazer being coined to refer to the jackets worn by the rowing club.
There we go.
The rowing team, however, turned the meaning of this offensive word on its head by embracing it and making it the designated, agreed-on name of this new jacket. They just turned it to their advantage. The rowing team wore their red jackets with pride, and the flurry of rude comments began to diminish over time. And as time passed, the word blazer made its way into common usage, and that style of jacket became very popular in a variety of colors, not just red, spreading from England to America by the 1900s. The blazer got a great boost in popularity in the late 19th century when the Royal Navy in England adopted new uniforms that closely resembled that Cambridge blazer, except that it was blue. The Navy blazer was blue. And I think they call that, you know, your classic
Navy
nautical
blue blazer.
Blue blazer.
Absolutely, yeah.
And that's what they call it, the nautical blue blazer. Now, one of the most, well, I just want to make sure I've made my point there. You know, a blazer refers to the fire engine red.
Absolutely.
Thing that they had at the.
Do you own any currently?
I have a
the
nautical blue blazer. Yes, I do.
One?
Yep. One.
How often do you pull that up?
Ooh. Well, much more when I was actually in a classroom and teaching teachers and other things, but not much anymore. Mm. Holding on to it just in case.
You know, when you do radio, it's good to look a little down, you know, in case you run into your adoring fans by the checkout desk. I'm just saying.
Yeah, well, that's, you know, if I'm just hiding my popularity by looking like a slob all the time, I guess.
Matt Anderson, I mean, yeah. I don't know about his radio show, but his blazer is fantastic.
Woo.
You know.
Well, I should have worn it.
I think so.
I didn't think, well.
No, that's all right.
Now, one of the most popular blazers in the world today is which one do you think, Jeff? Quiz time. One of the most famous types of blazer in the world today.
I mean, I'm thinking like, are we talking name brand, like Brooks Brothers or
no,
something?
No, not a brand.
Oh, okay.
It's one that's associated with an event and it's given once a year to someone.
I suppose, well, I don't know. Actually, I'm completely at a loss.
Oh, okay.
Goes to show you how my fashion sense is.
It's a sport associated with another sport.
Oh, so like a polo. Maybe like a polo. No.
You're getting there, but okay. No, not polo.
Geez, the hunting club. I don't know.
Someone should call in with this.
Yes. 555-1212.
We have some radio shows on Cedarburg Public Library Radio about this sport.
The golf blazer.
That's right. Which color is it?
Green.
Green.
Absolutely.
The forest green
course,
blazer.
The PG, the Masters.
The Masters.
Yes, of course, of course.
Augusta, Georgia.
There we go.
forest green in color. So there
the
you go.
The ugliest possible blazer, as far as I can really see. What a prize. You get like the it's like his 1970s. You look like you're ready for like a Leisure Suit Larry over there with your green blazer. That's just an opinion.
They're very conservative there. You know, do they even let women in the club? I don't know. That was a big deal.
Well, that's interesting too. Well, they do have the PGA women's division, so unfortunately, dividing genders in golf is truly the most ridiculous thing. You know, I mean, it is a sport that. You know, I mean, the precision and skill is what strikes me that it would cross all genders and, you know, races and everything. But it's like, no, we have to have men's and women's. And that's, I don't know. I'm opening a can of worms here on your show.
Well, men for centuries and thousands of years have always used that excuse. Women aren't as physically strong as men to deny them access to voting and education and positions of authority or careers because they're not smart enough, they're not strong enough. And that's a whole door. Boy, don't get me started on that one.
We have a whole season to unpack that one.
Oh, yes.
Now, the green blazer of Augusta.
But anyway, back to England, because it just occurred to me that, of course, the blazer originates in England. We then went to the Masters Golf Tournament for the green blazer. Now, let's travel back across the Atlantic. We mentioned golf. See, we're wandering here.
That's what we do.
Golf was invented in Great Britain, and that's in Scotland, to be precise,
right,
in the 1600s. And I always remember this. There's a Woodrow Wilson a quotation.
Ah, meaning it's real.
A quotation is a noun. Quote is a verb. So you don't ever say, right. I'm being picky out there, everyone.
Well, we should.
Grammar police.
I think it's time.
I'm going to give you this quote. No. A quotation is the noun, is the thing. The quote is the verb to do it.
I'm not going to forget it now. I feel like I've been schooled.
Good. You've been scolded.
I needed that.
Yeah, Jeff needed scolding here. Okay. Now, the Woodrow Wilson said, and he was an avid golfer. And he said, golf is a game in which one endeavors to control a ball with implements ill-adapted for the purpose. I thought that really...
That's so true.
Isn't it?
What a funny game, though, because, you know, we now really attribute it to presidents so much, because when our prior president, Mr. Obama, they love to use it, weaponize it, and say, oh, he's always on the golf course. And now our current president... who seems to enjoy the game just as much, if not more.
He owns a golf course, a number of them.
That's right. So, you know, and now the other side uses, go find him on the golf course. So it's really becoming kind of a negative, derogatory thing. I mean, I can see coming out of this century with a new, you know, a new insult to say, you're just on the golf course, aren't you?
Oh, gee. People always have to whine and complain about something. You know, oh, you're out on the golf course too much, then you get an office, and then you're on there even more.
Right.
I mean, what is that about?
Right. It's like quantifying our golfing.
Well, my question is, it's not so much about the politicians, it's about the public. Why are you swallowing this stuff?
Well, now you're really
Come
causing
on,
trouble.
Stop it.
That's awesome.
Think.
Exactly.
Read. I mean...
This is going to be a fun season of the show, I think. We're pretty hopped up this year. You know, we were very gentle last season. I think we're going to really eviscerate, you know.
Podcast.
Knives out, as they say.
Yeah, that's right. Have you ever played golf, Jeff?
Okay, so my history with golf is spotty at best. I carried my dad's golf bag initially, and only because at the end of those 9 holes, and you know, bless my father for only playing 9 and not 18, at the end of the 9 holes, traditionally was very good food at the clubhouse. So I carried the bag knowing that we had a place in Two Rivers called Fairview that had something called, I believe, like the Sheboygan Brat Bomber or something. At the end,
sounds
of the
lethal. It's amazing you're here today after a couple
It's
of
so
those.
Nice to be here to talk about it. So that was my impetus for... But then eventually I took golf lessons one winter in the Two Rivers Community House, which is a gigantic gym in the middle of on Washington Street for you natives. And you would play with wiffle balls, and you'd hit those around the gym. And it was a riot because you'd be on either side actually pelting each other with wiffle balls. So it was kind of bizarre. So the longest, shortest answer answer is yes and no. I enjoyed the lessons. I played a little bit, but I did not get that special thrill from the game. However, I'm interested, especially with Andy Fish, our PGA professional here on these airwaves. Every time he comes in and talks about the game, I get very excited about it because he's a very good salesman for the game. I mean, when you listen to him, you feel like you're a champion. He's a golf teacher, and what a great teacher, because even just sitting here in this room and there with nary a club to be found, I feel like I'm ready to take on, you know, Whistling Straits. You know?
Well, maybe we should do a remote show from Whistling Straits. There we go. Absolutely. But I've got more to say about golf here.
Absolutely.
I mean, but I just wanted to, you know, my one story about golf that could be interesting is that I used to be a caddy at Milwaukee Country Club when I was young, a teenager.
Well, I'm sure you have a million great stories.
Oh, well, here's the one that is true. And sat in the caddy shack and you get called out in groups of four. So the four of us got called out. We were up on the first tee with all of us sitting with our bags waiting for the people to arrive.
Oh, sure.
And then they all came out. And I was kind of distracted talking to someone to the left. And then the person who I was going to caddy for came up to the bag to take out their driver. And I looked up, and it was none other than Vince Lombardi.
Whoa.
So I caddy.
You were Lombardi's. That is amazing.
Yeah, Vince Lombardi's caddy for 18 holes.
Did he tip good?
Well, no, he was a guest. So it was the person who took him onto the course. He wasn't a member. He was just starting to be the coach of the Packers or whatever.
And okay.
Yeah, they hadn't done the Super Bowl thing yet, but that was soon to come.
Yeah, absolutely.
So there you go.
So I've seen the movie Caddyshack. I'm sure you have, too. That's almost a documentary for you in some ways, I'm sure, with your past.
Well, I tried to do a little better job than that for Vince.
That's good.
Vince.
Absolutely.
Now, the thing that also is interesting here is another little door. The original golf balls, I learned this, were made of feathers and leather.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, wet feathers were compressed into a small, very small sphere. And then when they were still wet, they were covered and tightly stitched up inside this piece of leather.
Yeah.
As tightly as possible. Now, as the feathers dried, they expanded.
Sure.
Making this small ball very,
tight.
Very hard.
Yeah, yeah.
And thus the first golf balls were created. That's kind of interesting. I thought feathers. It must have been very light.
And the first use of the term four.
Four.
Be very careful. Yeah.
And there's one more digression I'm going to,
Absolutely.
Since back to England here because of the university students who came up with the idea for the blazer.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Since that word appeared so many times in the above post, here's another word history. The word varsity, which is meaning the first string of a college or high school athletic team.
The best one. Yeah.
Comes to us from England and is a shortened form of the word university.
Oh, very nice. I had no idea.
Yeah. Originally in England, it meant the university team or their best players. Now, this derivation can be seen clearly because the word varsity first appeared, as far as historians are aware, Jeff, in 1846 and meant the teams of either Oxford or Cambridge universities. They were called varsity. That originated on those two campuses.
And then
spread throughout England, and then that's what we use today.
That's really interesting. So they just basically carved off the vowel of university and changed a vowel.
And here's another thing I found out. Let's give Oxford its due, because it's called Oxford University from the fact that it was founded and started near a fording place for oxen on a nearby river.
Still is.
Well, the highest class oxen, though, only. You know,
just went
class.
To war with that, bunch. So, very interesting. The varsity
Oxford.
Thing is, I'm glad you explained that today, because I've never fully grasped the idea of what a varsity team was. I thought, because you get a mishmash of, you get some freshmen, a couple sophomore, definitely a lot of seniors, and I was wondering how they cobble this together and what, you know, what kind of scale do they use? And it's obviously all subjective then. Yeah. And probably open for extreme debate and possibly controversy or versy.
Well, it's very much like this word fascination that we went over in a previous show, remember? That had to do with pornographic representations
on
the walls of buildings in ancient Rome with all of this. And
they have something called like junior varsity, which is, of course, then you're like, you're almost the best of the best. Is that how that works out?
In other words, not quite the best.
You're right, right. Yeah, so what a strange term, and I'm surprised that Americans have adopted that so and embraced it so much. You know?
Well, yeah, because during, we had gotten over that whole thing, you know, with the late 18th century and early 19th century of trying to establish our own identity as a nation and our own language and all that. So by the late 19th century, we were adapting a lot of British traditions because our aristocracy and the rich and the Carnegies and the Vanderbilts and the Astors, and they aped a lot of English habits in their upper class.
We had our own snobs. We don't need theirs anymore.
But they're American snobs.
So we like them better.
Yeah, we love them.
Yeah, we do. We embrace them.
Well, some people don't, but what the heck? Well, inequality, let's not go through that door right now because I wanted to ask you, Jeff.
Yes.
Here's something I found out. What is the difference between a blazer and a sport coat a suit coat?
I'm glad you asked that question. And you know why?
No.
Because we're going to break.
Oh, we are.
So we're gonna it's called a cliffhanger.
Oh, okay.
People have to come back and find out what the answer to those questions.
Well, I have a whole lot of other stuff, and we're going to get into Queen Victoria when we get back as well. So,
fantastic.
Here we go.
All right. Jumping at the Woodside is our break music, also from Benny Goodman. Nothing wrong with that. We'll be back.
Well, I like that song, Jeff.
It just came up automatically on my playlist.
Oh, there we go. I really like Benny. We have Benny Goodman all of the time here at History
Spaces. We can do that.
Yeah, I think so.
Deal.
Let's sample his catalog.
It's in the books.
Now, I left off. Difference between a blazer, sport coat, suit coat. Now, it seems out in the world of clothing, that is a big deal. Maybe we don't realize it, but here it is. A blazer is solid in color and has no pattern.
Right.
And it has metal buttons.
Oh, I didn't know that.
So a blazer has metal buttons, Jeff? It seems to be a distinguishing characteristic. But that, just the fact of that, reminded me of a story about buttons on the sleeves of suit coats, sport coats, and blazers. And even on the even on fall and winter coats, you ever notice they have these buttons that are on the sleeves?
Oh, sure. Yeah.
They serve no practical purpose. They don't button or attach anything to anything else.
They do get hooked frequently on car doors, your date's dress, leaving all kinds of problems. So, yeah.
Boy, I've been married a long time and love it, so I can't even remember what that's like because I date my wife every
day. Oh, that's
hi there, Lori. You're the best.
And you are. You earned some points today.
Oh.
Very good work. Well,
now, where did these buttons come from then? If they serve no practical purpose, who came up with this idea and where and what is it? Okay? And there's a story. Now, why buttons on the sleeve? And we have to go back to the Napoleonic Wars. From the 1790s through, Napoleon's demise in 1815.
It would be his fault.
Yeah, well, we can blame him.
Absolutely.
Sure. It was the sharp, red-coated soldiers of England during that period versus the stylish, blue-coated French troops. They were both very well, looked really wonderful.
So wait a minute, they wanted to look good on the battlefield?
Yeah, well, you know, the British had the red coats. And with the white pants, and then the white straps across their chest and the big hats and all that. And then the French had the big blue coats with their white white pants and then the high black boots. So they were really well-dressed on the battlefield. Now, Napoleon was very proud of the appearance of his soldiers. He would review his troops, and he noticed something, especially in cold weather, that the sleeves of their uniforms were discolored and dirty. And this disturbed him very much because he was a persnickety guy, and he was really invested in those good-looking uniforms. And he was told by his officers that the men would wipe the snot off their noses with the sleeves of their uniforms, especially when marching or in battle. They didn't have much time for anything else. You know, they were busy. Anyway, busy with other stuff. Couldn't rip out a hanky and take a break. So he ordered, to get over this, he ordered that rows of sharp-edged buttons be sewn onto the sleeves of the uniforms to discourage the practice.
What a creep.
Ouch. Yeah. Ouch. Now, these weren't just regular buttons. I mean, they were sharp, jagged things. Yeah, you would not want to do that to discourage it. Now, this stylistic change spilled over into civilian circles, and that's why to this day you have those useless buttons on the sleeves of both men and women's jackets and coats. Now, see, that just a little thing like that opens the door, and then here's a story for you. That's why that's there.
So those idiotic buttons are there because of an idiotic general who wanted his troops to look dapper on the blood fields of... This is insane.
Hey, they were winning battles. Let them wipe their sleeves with snot if
exactly.
they want.
Oh,
they're winning.
Gosh. So. General jerk. Well. Unbelievable.
But anyway, I thought that was kind
of
interesting.
That's amazing. I mean, we could stop that at any time.
Any
time, because nothing, you're not losing anything outside of a tribute to a 4'2" maniac. I mean, it's ridiculous.
But anyway, we have to leave Napoleon here, and we have to circle back to the blazer. Now, remember we started talking about what a blazer is, and
sure.
Metal buttons got us off into this, but blazers come in many colors now, pink, blue, yellow, colors galore. Especially during prom season in the spring, which is going to be coming and in two,
oh,
three
yeah.
months.
Absolutely.
I'm going to date myself by saying this. I remember the Lawrence Welk show. Have you ever watched that on PBS?
Oh, very much. Very much so. My grandfather was huge on it.
And some of those early color shows.
Yeah.
The blazers and jackets that those guys wore on that show were just outrageously colored.
Aqua, kind of turquoise.
Yeah, they were like, wow.
Yeah, absolutely.
Bright as green, any color out there, they had it. And I did a little bit of reading and found out Lawrence Welk wanted to take advantage of the early color technology.
Sure, sure.
So he dressed up the band and... that in these bright, bright blazers just to
well,
highlight everything.
Well, Myron Florin is so facially uninteresting, we gave him a bright blazer.
Yeah. Well, Myron Florin can stand tall on his own.
Absolutely.
He's the world's greatest accordion player.
He was very good.
Yeah. Now, what is a sport coat, though? How is that different from a blazer?
Ooh, what
now,
is the difference?
Now, if you're a tailor, you know all this,
right,
but
this
I have no idea. So I thought I'm just going to come and report. A sport coat has both pattern and comes in various colors. And it is it's a more casual coat that dates back to the 19th century in England, about the same time when the blazer came into being, when gentlemen would wear this kind of coat while engaging in outdoor activities such as golf, hunting, fishing. And thus the term sport coat, even though men do not use this jacket for those purposes any longer.
Wouldn't it be great if the NFL adopted sport coats on Sundays? Yeah. For the players? Yeah. You know?
Well, you know, these were kind of casual. They're not as formal looking. Sport coats can be very formal looking now, but then they're very casual. And men even wore a tie when they were out shooting or fishing or whatever, because gentlemen did this sort of thing.
Again, I think the Packers should play. They can keep the green and gold thing, but I want ties and sport coats next Sunday. Under their, you know, with the pads. They can still wear their pads, just oversized sport coats. Get David Byrne's sport coats from the Talking Heads. Those always had big shoulders, you know.
And, oh, yeah, I remember that.
I'm just thinking.
Stop Making Sense, isn't
right?
that the one, the movie?
Absolutely, yeah. So.
I love them. Now, here's. You have a blazer, sport coat, now a suit coat. And a suit coat isn't much different from a sport coat, but, Jeff, what does it have that the other doesn't?
Lack of buttons.
No, it has a matching set of trousers. So it has a more formal look about it because they match.
Oh,
the trousers
I see,
and the coat match.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay.
Sport coat, you can have another color trouser or even khakis, whatever. So
you still can't wipe your snot on it, though.
No, don't do that.
All right.
If you're on a date, don't do that.
No, just don't. Yeah, especially for prom.
But you're going to impress your date with that story. Oh, I mean, yeah. If you want to.
Oh, yeah. She'll love that.
Yeah, I'm sure she'll be all ears with that one.
The first thing you tell her when she gets in the car. You know what I heard on History Spaces? That, by the way, that would totally be me. That's why my dating record is very spotty.
So, anyway, this is too strange. Now, a fashion note. Any of these items, you know, can be dressed up with a pair of high-top Converse tennis shoes, just in case
sure.
you wanted to know.
Absolutely.
Sport coat, suit coat, or blazer.
You know, David Letterman in the late 80s and through on his NBC show, once he got to CBS, he became a bit more formal when he moved over to the Ed Sullivan Theater. But on his later NBC show, Late Night with David Letterman, he was one of the first on television to wear a sport coat and, you know, slacks with tennis shoes. He wore tennis shoes for probably like 5 years on his show. And it was cool. It became kind of the epitome of cool, you know, and back when then. So.
And my latest glimpses of him show him to be even more casual now with the big beard.
Kind of looks like the Unabomber now.
Yeah.
So, yeah. <it's> but, you know, all things
now,
to all
now.
People.
Okay. Now, here's something else. You know, way leads on to way and all that. So this all begs the question, where does the necktie originate? No, because neckties go with blazers.
Just going head to toe here today, aren't we?
I mean, really. Now, we have to go back to the 17th century.
Okay.
1668. We have a date here. Yeah. In 1668, a regiment of Croatian mercenary horse soldiers made an appearance in France during the 30 Years' War. And they were wearing elaborate and colorful linen and muslin scarves around their necks. And other stories say that these soldiers appeared wearing colorful capes, probably both capes and scarves, that blew in the wind behind them as they rode on their horses. And they gave a very dashing appearance, Jeff.
Absolutely.
Kind of like we do here when we're sitting in the
absolutely.
Studio. Very dashing. Yeah.
You should see us, folks.
Yes. Now, fashion-conscious French men and women were very taken with these colorful capes and or scarves, depending on what story you believe. Now, upper-class men and women began to appear in public wearing colorful pieces of linen and lace around their necks, either in the form of a cape or a scarf. And both were attached to the necks of the wearer using fancy, elaborate knots with long flowing ends. Now, you can just see this. Now, the French call these knots and ties at the neck cravats.
Oh, absolutely, yes.
Yeah. Which was their name for Croatians.
Yeah.
Who inspired this new fashion. And this is called an eponym, if you really want to know. But it's when a word in, how can I say? I'll have to skip over that.
Right.
I want to stay on my subject here.
There we are.
Now, the fashion spread quickly to England, and over time, the cravat, remember, which came from the French word for Croatians, the cravat became smaller and smaller and smaller. The cape-like and elaborate neck decorations became more simple. And by the 20th century in America, the necktie as we know it today was established. And I even remember the string ties of the 1960s. I still have a couple at home.
Oh, sure, sure.
I wear them every once in a while just
absolutely.
For fun. What the heck? Now, here's again, you thought we're done maybe. How much can we really squeeze out of like a suit coat blazer? But we're not done yet.
I would think not.
Nope. Another detail of a blazer, sport coat, suit coat is the buttonhole.
Oh, sure.
Button-y,
yes.
That's up in the lapel.
Absolutely.
Ever notice that there is no corresponding button that could be used with that buttonhole?
You're just debunking the entire garment industry this morning, aren't you?
Well, these are things maybe you haven't thought about, but really are worthy of deep thought.
So he's gonna go straight to the garment industry, and they're going to say, some guy named Anderson in Cedarburg is asking dangerous questions.
Yeah, no. NSA is monitoring every word we say. Now, no corresponding button for the buttonhole in your lapel. Now, where did that come from? Now, a story that I'm familiar with is that Victoria and Albert, Queen of England, Queen Victoria, and the Prince Consort Albert, were standing in a receiving line at a royal occasion, and the Queen, being first in line, was greeting guests, but was distracted by Albert. They had just been married, and he was a very handsome man, and she was very much in love with him. Her eyes caught sight of a beautiful vase of flowers across the hall in which they were standing. And so she suddenly broke out of line, and everyone stopped, thinking, what was the queen doing? She went to the bouquet across the hall, broke off a flower, and came back, and looking Albert in the eyes lovingly, gave him the flower as a token of her love.
Aha.
Well, the royal couple continued to greet guests, but Albert found it awkward holding the flower in his hands, because he was supposed to be, you know, looking a little more dignified, not holding onto a flower. Flower in his hand. He couldn't put it down, so what could he do? Then he had an idea. He had a servant get him a small knife, and he cut a small hole in the lapel of his jacket. That was one expensive jacket, too. Okay. And placed the flower in the hole, and this freed both his hands and made him more comfortable. Now, there you go. Another version, though, of this story says, Victoria presented Albert a small bouquet of flowers on their wedding day, and that he made the gentlemanly gesture of cutting a hole in his lapel to hold some of the flowers.
Aha.
Now,
either way, it goes back to flowers.
So there you go. But there is even another story that I came across. I thought, well, how many stories can you have for the same thing?
The same buttonhole.
But here, this is an unquestioned good source, GQ magazine.
Oh, okay. Well.
Yeah. Well, they say.
Be all, end all. Yeah.
They reported that the hole is in the lapel because a string or piece of cord used to be attached to men's hats, and at the end of which was a button. It was at the other end of this cord. There was a button that could be attached to this buttonhole in the lapel to prevent a gentleman's hat from blowing away.
Now, that's functional. I can get behind that. That is fine. Yeah. This flower thing is ridiculous. I mean, here's the thing. What if she gave him, like, a ham sandwich? Well, then we have, like, a special, like, ham sandwich slight, you know, like an extra sandwich
you
pocket.
I mean, a ham sandwich as a tribute to him for her love?
Of course.
What more loving thing could she have done than giving him a ham sandwich?
It's
you heard it here first.
It's good he wasn't Jewish. But yeah, I mean, it's you know, it's an interesting thing. I'm just underscoring how strange human beings are.
You know, I think both could be true, because you could have the flower story could be true, but this was a way also to utilize the buttonhole in a more practical, ongoing way.
Right, right.
And in addition, you know, giving it additional functionality,
absolutely,
that little buttonhole.
I mean, we obviously have to deal with corsages at times. You know, and so having a hole for something like that is logical. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can see that. Although frequently they just pin it to you. They pin, of course, you know, that's what you get. So, I mean, it's a strange thing. I don't.
Oh, by the way, I wanted to mention, you had mentioned the ham sandwich as a tribute.
Yes. As I'm prone to do
that
on these airwaves.
I'll let you know what my wife thinks of that when I make a ring.
should bring her one today. There's nothing more romantic.
She's pretty much a vegetarian, so I...
Imagine her surprise.
But I was reading, and here's evidence of all the great, deep, and meaningful reading that I do.
Absolutely.
Is that I was reading and came across the fact that it was in the 1820s when a cookbook came out with a recipe for a ham sandwich and kind of formalized the introduction of the sandwich into American culture. There was, in this cookbook in the 1820s, a recipe for making a ham sandwich and presenting it as a meal for your family.
So, I should do that on the radio here. I should do, I should say, you know, first you take two slices of bread, then you get your meat.
Yeah.
Thanks for tuning in, everybody.
I hope. Well,
we're here for you.
We're... Let's see if we can get serious here for a moment.
We'll do our best.
Yeah. So anyway, take your pick of those stories. I mean, I think they're all maybe true. Who knows? A few more things we take for granted today that Queen Victoria was responsible for. We've talked about a number of things already.
Oh, sure.
I mean, gosh. Wearing white at weddings.
Oh, yeah.
She wore a white wedding dress. This was not common at all. But when she did it at her wedding in the 1840s, I believe, sure what it was, 30s, she got married when she was 21. But that caught on with others in the upper classes. And then now by today, well, it's just.
Well, apparently it's supposed to send a message.
Yeah.
It's a targeted message to your to your wedding guests that you are of pure heart and mind and everything else.
But in other cultures it's not true.
No,
white is not a wedding.
It's a funeral dress in Korea.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I mean, so
in,
you know.
In India I saw this in Indian wedding and all the saris and the beautiful colors. It's so colorful. It's not monochromatic white at all. Yeah. It's so joyful.
Absolutely.
So yeah, just look into that. I mean, those are fun. Now, something else, Jeff. Pot smoking is common today.
And getting commoner by the hour.
Yeah. Well, I noticed, in the last month or two, they've granted even more liquor licenses in Cedarburg. I mean, it's like, really? How many places do we need that we can consume alcohol, but we can't have that CBD store? I mean,
if we can get everyone drunk, they won't crave pot. That's the goal here. We got to get everyone blitzed.
What did those people say at the meetings? When they were trying to get that passed. That we can't have that. What will our students think?
Right,
having the downtown full of CBD and all that. Well, my God, my daughter used to be down here with all of her friends, and the young people already are really ticked off because they have to walk around. They work in these bars and restaurants and things. Yeah. The parents, people they know, come in and they drink and they get drunk and they go out and they drive away. Well, already, what sort of example is that setting?
Isn't it nice to have someone with a lampshade on their head tell you how to behave?
Yeah. And then the town council, more liquor licenses. Right, let's just spread it around. But we can't have that CBD store.
They'll get ideas.
Have a little bit of thought about this stuff.
Haven't you heard? We're done with thought. we are expunging it.
We're into alternative facts.
Yes, absolutely.
But here's another thing. Victoria was a pot smoker. Queen Victoria.
Wow.
Yeah, wow. She was. And she had extreme menstrual cramps. They were very extreme. She was in a lot of pain, and so she smoked marijuana. It gave her relief, and it was all
legal. Conservative
old
men find both pot and menstrual cramps offensive, though. See, that's the problem.
That's no excuse. Right. That's God's punishment on you for picking that apple off the tree. It was a banana or something else, but who cares?
Going back to the pomegranate.
Right? I know. When you can't win.
No, you really
no
can't.
Kidding.
That's our message for today.
Yeah, it was legal. Now I found this interesting. I mean, I've been reading in the paper, pot's legal now in recreational pot. Illinois, Michigan, Minnesota.
States are tumbling to the green wave. I mean, absolutely.
Yeah, Wisconsin, we're holding out, though.
We will be number 50, by the way. I'm sure of the 50th state to go green.
I mean, when it went legal in Illinois on January 1st, one of these news shows, these local news shows, which are nothing more than a rag. I mean, what is
this?
Oh, it's legal in Illinois, but let's they had an interview with one of these sheriffs down in a county on the Illinois line.
Yeah.
And he was like, well, it doesn't matter if it's legal there. We're going to keep an eye out for that. And really, and if there's any indication that we can pull you all, we're going to search for that sort of thing.
We actually we put a garrison up on the roller coasters of Great America so we can watch the border better. We just parked the roller coaster.
My wife and daughter had a great comment after that thing. She said, well, why in the hell don't you get your butts out there and stop all the sex trafficking coming out of Chicago, right up through Milwaukee and up into the Fox River Valley. It's a horrible situation.
Oh, absolutely.
But,
yeah.
You know, we're worried about pot smoking, but never mind the, you know, the white slavery going on.
It's all the apple tree. It's the apple tree.
Because women, you did it. You know, it was all your fault.
Oh, boy. We got a long ways to go.
Got it. So, anyway, write your letters to the library if you don't like what we're saying.
Right.
Yeah. Now, it's only in the last 90 years that pot's been an issue since the 1930s, basically.
Right.
So, now, lastly, Victoria gave birth to 7 children. Without pain relief, even though she had a lower pain threshold. Lower in, well, men's pain threshold is very low compared to women giving birth to children. She gave birth to 7 children without pain relief. That's a wow.
That's not even Tylenol.
Now, because it was forbidden by the medical establishment to give pain relief during childbirth. They would not do it. And here's where it comes from. Reinforced by the Christian church as Eve's punishment for her sin in the Garden of Eden. Okay? Just want to emphasize that.
I'm shaking my head right now, but you can't hear it on the radio.
Also, words came from the pulpit from all the ministers throughout the lands in the United States, England, Europe, that this is the reason why it was denied and forbidden by medical practice, religious dogma, etc. The woman's screams of pain will waft up to heaven and be as music to the ears of God. Because he wanted to hear that.
Well, at least there's science behind it. I wanted to make sure that there was some heavy science there.
Oh, okay. Everything's fine.
It can be quantified.
But Victoria, after 7 kids, she had had enough. That was it. She said, the hell with this stuff. Excuse me for saying that.
Absolutely.
But
no.
She demanded relief. I can just see this picture, grabbing him by the shirt. You will give me pain relief. I order you. And, well, she was the queen. And once the queen had done it and broken the taboo, the practice spread and was more commonly accepted. Not that certain women of another class or another belief system might have had help from midwives
and
all that, but just general societal practice. And if you ask the medical establishment, run by men, and the religious establishment, run by men, they would have said, no, it's forbidden. Now, but Jeff,
this show is run by men.
Whoa. So, we could fix that, I suppose.
Well, we'll see what we could do in the coming days.
But we're not yet done yet there, Jeff.
No.
I have one more thing. We started out with Oxford and rowing sculling team and moved on from there. But there's one more story to tell.
It's been quite a
tour. I think it's, Now, we're going to go to New York City in 1844. There was an election that year for mayor. Okay. Now, evidently, crime was a big issue still. We talk about it now. They talked about it then. This reform candidate in the mayoral election in 1844 promised to create the first full-time, trained, uniformed police department in the United States. As I said, crime must have been an issue because, anyway, before this, it was done with volunteers who patrolled the streets. And evidently he was quite popular because of this position, and he won the election.
There you go.
Okay. So he established the force, trained them, and put them in uniforms, which were blue in color. Wow. That's kind of the common color for police. Blue Lives Matter, as that phrase says.
That's right, yeah.
And the uniforms had shiny copper buttons like new pennies on the new uniforms. Now, imagine that. A dark navy blue new uniform with bright copper buttons, someone walking down the street. Now, street smart criminals and delinquents noted this and made up what they thought to be an insulting nickname for these now highly visible symbols of authority. They were called coppers.
Very good.
Which was eventually shortened to cops and lives in our vocabulary to this very day. Now, of course, that's not the only story.
Oh, no.
there's another one floating around out there that it's an abbreviation, a word created from a series of words, citizens on patrol from England.
Okay, sure.
They used to have volunteer citizens patrolling the streets.
Sure, sure.
COP, cop. Now, that's I don't know if that's true or not. I like the story I just told you, but here's another one. It derives from the Dutch word kapen, K-A-P-E-N, meaning to take, as in a thief.
Oh, okay. You
know? Or maybe it's a bribe. I don't know. That's kind of interesting. Well. So, you see, once you open the door, way leads on to way. It's amazing. So that's where we started with the blazer in Oxford, and we ended up in New York City in 1844 with cops and...
Perfect.
But that's it, Jeff.
Fantastic.
You know, it's interesting how one thing leads to another, and I hope I kept everyone's attention with a lot of major digressions. But thanks, Jeff.
It's a major digression day here on History Spaces, and that's why we come. That's why we enjoy it. So we're going to end. We were talking about... Well, we were ending with... talking about Illinois a little bit and how there's it's a little cloudy down there maybe today, a little extra cloud. This is Chicago from Benny Goodman again. So next week, come back.
I love it.
And we'll talk about more stuff on History Spaces.
More stuff. Okay, bye, everyone.